In 1976, an album was released by the then unknown French artist Jean-Michel Jarre, which rewrote the rulebook of synthesizers and electronic music and captured the hearts and imagination of the entire world. The album, Oxygene, broke out of France to become a top 10 album in 7 different countries, spending a remarkable 24 weeks in the UK album charts and selling an estimated 15 million copies worldwide. This feat is made even more impressive by the contents of the album, featuring only 6 songs, not even with full titles, just numbered Oxygene Parts 1 through 6, and being entirely instrumental with no acoustic instruments whatsoever, something which, although now is common practice, was unheard of and very rare in 1976. In this video, we'll explore the making of Oxygene by Jean-Michel Jarre, a tale which is almost as extraordinary as the album itself. To understand the making of this landmark album, we must first learn about its enigmatic creator, Jean-Michel Jarre. Jean-Michel Jarre was born in Lyon on August the 24th, 1948, into a very musical family, with his father being notable film composer Maurice Jarre, who scored films such as Lawrence of Arabia and Dead Poets Society, and his grandfather also being a musician, as well as inventor who created the first ever audio mixing desks used by Radio Lyon. Jarre's musical development began at an early age, as he was exposed to much jazz, classical, and pop music of the day, and had piano lessons on and off throughout his childhood until, at age 13, he became obsessed with rock music, even selling his train set in order to buy a guitar and tape recorder. Unlike most parents at the time, Jean-Michel's mother was highly encouraging of the path that her son was on, and arranged for him to take lessons in harmony, counterpoint, and fugue at the infamous Paris Conservatory. Jean-Michel spent the rest of his teenage years playing in local bands whilst simultaneously becoming interested in the creation and manipulation of sound and tape recorders, and spending many hours producing and altering weird sounds with his Grundig tape recorder. At age 20, Jean-Michel was convinced that this new type of electroacoustic music, as it was known at the time, was to become his life. Jean-Michel then enrolled at the Music Research Group, or GRM, in 1968, which was the first school in France to specialise in electroacoustic and electronic sound creation. This was, once again, like many things in Jarre's life, no easy feat, as there were only 4 places available, and Jarre was one of 200 candidates. To earn his place, Jarre had to complete an exam where each student was given a percussion instrument, a tape recorder, a microphone, scotch tape, magnetic tape, and scissors, and was given 4 hours to create and record a piece of music. Whilst at the GRM, Jean-Michel was taught how to use very early synthesizers and oscillators not intended for use in music at all, under the influence of Pierre Schaeffer, who Jarre cites as his biggest influence, and who taught Jarre a philosophy which would later become the foundation of the Oxygene album and all of Jarre's musical output. This philosophy was that the difference between noise, like wind or rain, and sound, such as musical notes, is the intention of the composer. This idea that music was just as much about noise as it was notes and melodies was perhaps the most important building block in the creation of the Oxygene album. During his time there, Jean-Michel was also lucky enough to spend time working with 2 early electronic music pioneers, Terry Riley and Karlheinz Stockhausen. After leaving the GRM in 1971, Jean-Michel spent most of the early 1970s working as a songwriter and composer for television and advertising, and also writing for many successful artists, including Christophe and Patrick Jouvet, all whilst making his own electronic music in the background. Now here we fast forward to the summer of 1976, where things begin to become really interesting. This summer was perhaps the most important point in Jean-Michel Jarre's entire life, as for the first time he found himself all alone for 8 weeks in an empty home with nothing to do. Having recently separated from his first wife and his then wife-to-be Charlotte Rampling, abroad making films throughout the whole summer. Having just enough money to last him the entire 8 weeks, Jean-Michel decided that he was going to make an album, virtually entirely alone, which would incorporate the key philosophies of experimental music he had learned of combining noise and sound and melody together, and also bridging the gap between experimental electronic music and more contemporary pop music. The other aspect of the album's creation, which was highly unusual for its time, was that Jarre would record the album entirely at home, in a makeshift studio set up in his now empty kitchen, with a selection of early and primitive analog synthesizers, which he had bought with the money from his songwriting endeavors, and an old second-hand 8-track recorder. To add to the list of complications and challenges he faced was the fact that all of his synthesizers were monophonic, meaning that they were capable of only playing one note at a time and were entirely analog, meaning every single sound had to be designed and created from scratch and could never be replicated or saved afterwards. Little did Jean-Michel know at the time that this 8-week period would change his life forever and redefine electronic music and make him a household name. It is an understatement that Jean-Michel had somewhat of a mountain to climb. And at that time, he was mocked and even laughed at by fellow musicians for recording music at home, with real music only being made in giant studios with big budgets and producers. An environment which Jean-Michel knew would not suit the creation of his electronic music. Undeterred by all the criticism and challenges, he set out on his incredible 8-week journey, determined to create something special. The other philosophy and concept that Jean-Michel wanted to put across in the album was, as he calls it, the contrast between sunny and dark in music, which Jarre believes is part of why the album is so successful. Whilst making the album, Jarre barely slept and was fully consumed by the album's creation all through the blisteringly hot 8 weeks in his kitchen. The album begins with Oxygene Part 1, and right away Jean-Michel lays out the album's sonic framework, as the album begins with a simple delay pattern created on his Eminent organ and beautiful washes of white noise, created by the first synthesizer Jarre ever owned, the EMS VCS3. Jarre's use of this synthesizer was very unique, as he used it not for playing notes, but for creating sequences of white noise and ambient sound using the synthesizer's noise generator paired with flanging and phasing effects, with each sequence being created and performed live by Jarre. Jean-Michel spent hours crafting these swells of white noise, as he wanted each one to inhabit, as he describes it, its own world and separate universe within the music. The white noise also served, however, a much greater purpose on the album rather than just as a spacey effect and artistic flair. As because Jean-Michel Jarre was recording at his home studio, each synthesizer added an incredible amount of hum and hiss to the 8-track tape, which he was able to carefully cover over with the white noise. Oxygene Part 1 has been described by Jarre as his own electronic symphony, leaning heavily towards classical music, with the sound of his Eminent organ, the first ever to provide a synthesized string sound, driving the piece forward with a beautiful, classically inspired chord sequence, perfectly underscored with melodies and harmonies from his other synthesizers and healthy amounts of ambient noise. As Oxygene Part 1 fades away with more beautiful ambient noise from the VCS3, we are introduced to another one of the album's key instruments, Jarre's Korg Mini Pops drum machine, a preset machine which held several dull drum patterns. That is, until one day, Jean-Michel made a huge discovery. This discovery was that by using a super high-tech piece of sellotape, he was able to tape down two buttons for two different drum patterns, which then played them both at the same time, which allowed Jarre to create the exciting futuristic beats for the album. Curiously enough, Jean-Michel deliberately composed Oxygene Part 2 before Oxygene Part 1, in order to have a more accurate idea of how the album should start and how it should build towards Part 2. Oxygene Part 2 was created almost as a rebellion against his electronic contemporaries of the day, such as Kraftwerk, whose music, although groundbreaking, like much of the electronic music of its time, was based around repetition, repeating the same robotic patterns over and over and over again without any deviation. Jean-Michel was determined that his music would be as human and emotive as possible, with each repetition of the same sound or melody being altered slightly in timbre and tone as if it was performed by a musician on a traditional instrument. Oxygene Part 2 also introduces one of the few polyphonic instruments on the album, Jarre's mellotron, which he salvaged from a studio session with barely any working keys. The beginning of Oxygene Part 3 introduces us to another influence of Jarre's on the album, science fiction, particularly the Stanley Kubrick film 2001: A Space Odyssey, and the film's journey into deep space, with Jarre replicating the haunting moments of the film's soundtrack, using the eminent organ to create dissonant chord clusters full of random notes, with a lone kick drum carrying the rhythm of the piece. It is perhaps at this point on the album we can clearly hear another groundbreaking element which contributed to the album's success, which was the innovative use of effects such as delay, which Jarre created by running each sound through a Revox tape machine, creating a huge sense of space within the music. It is also in Part 3 where Jarre's haunting use of the Synthi AKS synthesizer shines through, with Jarre manually controlling its volume and vibrato to create the electronic equivalent of an operatic soprano vocal. After some more lovely ambient noise, side one of the album concludes and the listener is immediately greeted by the hugely popular single of the album, Oxygene Part 4. Oxygene Part 4 was composed by Jarre entirely in one night, with Part 4 being inspired by the feeling of driving down a motorway at ridiculous speed, with its melody also being inspired by Gershon Kingsley's hugely successful 1969 synthesizer hit Popcorn. Perhaps here is the perfect place to mention Jarre's sole collaborator on the album, audio engineer, musician and instrument designer Michel Geiss, who Jean-Michel first met around 1974. After purchasing an ARP 2600 synthesizer, Jarre heard through a friend that Michel Geiss was an expert on the instrument, with Geiss quickly becoming a trusted friend of Jean-Michel, teaching him everything he needed to know about the ARP and other synthesizers. Geiss's influence can most clearly be heard on the second half of the album, with Geiss taking Jean-Michel to a music fair and recommending the purchase of an RMI keyboard computer and, most importantly, the RMI harmonic synthesizer, which features heavily on the second half of the album. Geiss's role in the album was mainly as an engineer, most of the time simply hitting record and stop on the tape machine, allowing Jean-Michel to focus entirely on the playing, and designing some of the album's ARP 2600 synthesizer sounds, one of which being the lead sound on Oxygene Part 4. We now come to my personal favorite piece on the album, Oxygene Part 5, which in itself is a piece in two halves, with Jarre first showing off his love of minimalism, once again opening the piece with some beautiful ambient noise and some lovely chords from the eminent organ processed with a flanger to give it some glorious shimmering harmonics. The first part of the piece is a brilliant exercise in tension and release and is my favourite moment on the whole album. It is in the second half of the piece where the RMI harmonic synthesizer shines, with its built-in arpeggiator giving us a wonderfully hypnotic bass loop, which carries the rest of the piece, along with an excellent keyboard solo from Jarre. Oxygene Part 6 begins with the sound of synthesized crashing waves, created by Michel Geiss, and was written by Jarre to evoke memories of his childhood and holidays with his grandparents, almost serving as a more mellow counterpart to Part 4, with a similar use of the Korg mini pops and a wonderful exploration of dissonance and harmony with its often dark and explorative melody. Jarre likened this part of the album to electronic lounge music, with the piece serving as the perfect coda to an album in which Jarre, using only four monophonic synthesizers, the VCS3, Synthi AKS, ARP 2600 and RMI Harmonic synthesizer, two electric organs, the Eminent and Farfisa, a Mellotron and the Korg Mini Pops drum machine, managed to change the sound of electronic music forever. It is unclear at exactly what time during the making of the album this next event occurred, with Jarre giving slightly different accounts in interviews over the years, and each party involved giving a slightly different timeline and version of events. So for this video, we'll be going with the account given by Jarre in his 2019 autobiography, Melancholique Rodeo. Jarre writes that after the album's completion, he engaged in one of his favourite pastimes, visiting various Paris art galleries, until in the window of one gallery, a piece caught his eye that he was instantly drawn to. A painting of a skull hidden within the earth. After entering the gallery, Jean-Michel discovered that it was a painting by young artist Michel Granger, titled Oxygene, who, by chance, happened to be at the gallery at this exact moment. The pair began talking and Jean-Michel bought the painting to use as his album cover. The album now had an equally exciting piece of artwork and title to complement the music, and was then mixed at Studio Gang by Jean-Pierre Jeannaud, a very accomplished engineer who gave the album its final layer of sheen and polish. Jarre then took the album to his old boss, Francis Dreyfus, owner of the Discress Motors record label, who he had worked for during his songwriting days with Christophe. Francis instantly became enthralled with the album and was convinced it would be a worldwide success. The pair then set about finding an international record company to take the album further. Unfortunately, absolutely no record company was interested in the album, with the common criticism being that it was an album with no singer, no guitars, no drummer, no proper track titles, no singles, and to top it all off, it was French. Even Jean-Michel's mother was not convinced, as although she loved the music, she said to Jean, "Why are you naming your album after a gas and putting a skull on the cover? It's not going to work." Francis Dreyfus, however, was determined to make Oxygene a success and pressed 50,000 copies on his own label to sell in France in December 1976. The selling of these initial pressings of the album was also greatly helped by a brainwave of Francis and Jarre, which was to send and stock the album in hi-fi shop, as the album's innovative use of stereo and synth bass not only made buyers in these stores want to buy the best, most expensive hi-fi system, but also a copy of the album to go with it. With very little promotion, the album sold extremely well in France, some dazzled by it and others confused, with many returning the LP, believing all of the white noise was a manufacturing defect. Then, in 1977, Oxygene was set to dominate the world, after being discovered in a French record store by Dutch DJ Freddy Heyen, who had recently been appointed as head of Polydor Records in London. After discovering the album, he took it to England and gave the album to BBC Radio 1, who played the album in full. The only other album to ever receive such an honour was Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon. And on August 23rd, 1977, Oxygene entered the UK album charts at number 19, and then had a run of 11 weeks in the top 10 of the UK album charts. The album was mostly slated by the UK's mainstream music press, with the Enemy calling it another interminable sonic cruise and infuriatingly derivative. This didn't matter though, as suddenly Jean-Michel Jarre's life changed forever, and against all odds he had created a worldwide hit, all in his kitchen, that is counted as one of the most influential and groundbreaking albums of all time. Thank you all for joining me for the Making of Oxygene by Jean-Michel Jarre. I really enjoyed researching this one and I learned so many interesting facts about Jean-Michel Jarre, and it was like I was able to re-appreciate one of my favourite albums of all time from a whole new perspective. Thank you all for watching and I hope to see you all again very soon.